I'm very happy to turn the mic over to Ryan Oakes, who is an artist and who, along with his twin brother, was actually the opening artist in our art gallery upstairs. The very first art show we had here featured the work of Ryan and Trevor Oakes. It was phenomenal. You should look them up online as well. They've gone on to continue doing wonderful things. And so I'm very pleased to pass the mic to Ryan.
Thank you, Cindy, for inviting me back to MoMath. It's a pleasure to be here. As Cindy mentioned, I work with my twin brother. We collaborate, and we had the privilege of doing the inaugural art show, where we explored our various bodies of artwork, which rub up against mathematics in a number of ways. But today, I'm here to introduce Doug McKenna, who's going to be speaking about the golden ratio. And by way of introduction, I'll run through a little bit of a bio of Doug's broad career, spanning over 50 years, running back to when he was a teenager. So he's done many things, ranging from digging for dinosaur fossils, rowing a wooden boat down the Grand Canyon, and starting life in New Jersey, where his father was a curator at the Museum of Natural History, the Frick Curator for Mammals. Which got him involved in thinking deeply about creative explorations from an early age. As a teenager, he began computer programming. This is in the 1970s, and then went on to study at Yale in math and computer science. And while he was there, he explored the topic of space-filling curves and the accompanying illustrations of those concepts, which were executed some through hand techniques and some through computer techniques, which was very new at the time. After Yale, he spent some time in Montana, but his work with the space-filling curves attracted the attention of Mandelbrot, who hired him to work at IBM to doing illustrations of fractals, which again was very cutting edge at the time. So Doug McKenna drew many illustrations for Mandelbrot's famous publication, The Fractal Geometry of Nature, and many of those illustrations were published in the Smithsonian's magazine in 1983 with their first article covering the topic of fractals. In 1986, Doug McKenna began doing programming and developer work for Macintosh computers and worked on a developer tool called Resourcerer, which I wonder if anybody used that tool. It was critical to Macintosh programming at the time, and it was so well received that the tool won an Eddie Award in 1993, which is the equivalent of the Oscars for Macintosh software. Doug McKenna has done a broad range of disciplines, including collaborating with DNA researchers at Harvard more recently, and he's currently working on an interactive math ebook, which is documenting and explaining his explorations and discoveries to a broader audience. Doesn't stop there. He's recently dipped into fashion design and has designed a number of silk scarves and fabrics, which are actually available in the shop upstairs. I encourage you to check those out. He's working on those with his collaboration with his daughter. And today, he's going to be discussing the golden ratio, as he'll get into. So to lead into that, I'll give you this quote by Mario Livio about the golden ratio. The golden ratio has inspired thinkers of all disciplines like no other number in the history of mathematics. Doug comes to us from Boulder, Colorado, and please give him a warm welcome.
Hello. Thank you. Happy New Year, or as I like to say, happier New Year. And thank you, Ryan, for that introduction, and MoMA and the Simons Foundation. I'm going to talk to you about the golden ratio and actually the art of dissecting certain simple geometries that are related to the golden ratio. I'm going to say some controversial and maybe snarky things that are intended to be funny and make you think a little bit. Some of this work I did in the 80s before there was PostScript and I was working on pen plotters, I've done some work since, and then some of it I did just in the last year. And this talk is based on a talk I did for the Bridges Math Art Conference. So I like playing with mathematics and trying to create images that are pleasing to the eye for various reasons, either aesthetically or mathematically. And I kind of think about mathematical and beauty in sort of terms of this dialectic. So on the math side, there's Platonic beauty. If you listen to people talking about beauty, there's, especially mathematicians, they're all about Platonic beauty. And artists are all about whatever is aesthetic, and it's an ill-defined word. But the thing about the tension between the two, in my mind, is always sort of this upside-down, you know, catenary or parabola or ellipse, whatever the curve is. And there's this unstable point at the top where there's this wonderful sweet spot balance between the two, but almost everybody kind of falls to one side. And that tension is sort of a tension between the world of constraint and the world of choice. And mathematicians are always about studying constraint and the emergent patterns from constraint, and whether they start with constraint and find the patterns, or whether they start with the patterns and then go find constraints is an interesting thing. And then artists are about choice and making, you know, even Jackson Pollock had a set of rules, and he made certain choices. But so there's that tension. And then there's also a tension between symmetry and asymmetry. And so mathematicians love symmetry. They write entire books about symmetry. You know, half the things in this museum are probably about symmetry. But artists aren't so interested in symmetry. And in fact, you know, other than certain areas of architecture, most artists don't create things that are symmetric. You know, if you look at Kandinsky's paintings, the first abstract painter, not a single one of them is, say, bilaterally symmetric or rotationally symmetric. And why is that? Well, you know, if you had a painting that was bilaterally symmetric, it would be a complete aesthetic ripoff. You know, there'd be one bit of information for half of the painting. So, you know, even the Mona Lisa is asymmetric, as are almost, you know, as are all of our faces. And so there's this tension there. And the thing about the golden ratio, and I'll get to explaining that in a minute, is that it is this tension between symmetry and asymmetry is sort of exemplified by the golden section. So I'll do a little bit of pretty simple math, and then the rest of the talk is going to be about pictures that sort of embody pictorially some of these mathematical concepts, because that's just, you know, that's where it's more fun to explore in my mind. So what is a section? A section is when you take something that you measure, a foot, you know, a ruler, a yardstick, or, you know, a mile, and you want to cut it into two pieces at some point. So you choose a point, you call it X, and you say, okay, we're going to divide this at X. So you can choose any X you want. You can choose a quarter and get it, and you know, and the other piece is 3/4, or you choose a third and 2/3, or a half and a half, so that's right in the middle, that's a symmetric choice. You choose a ninth and 1/10, and so forth. And in mathematics, mathematicians like to go the distance, and they'll even talk about dividing something up into two pieces, one of which is non-existent. So you can have X equal to 1 or 0, and so that turns out to be useless in the real world, but it's elegant in the mathematical world. So we're choosing this X, and it can be any, it's a measurement. It can be a real number anywhere between 0 and 1. And so the question is well, what can you do with that? Well, you already know how to add them together because they add up to 1. So what about dividing them? So let's create the ratio of these. What does that mean? Well, the distance of the smaller piece is x minus 0, so that's just x, and the other one's 1 minus x. So what's the ratio? It's x over 1 minus x. So you can see a pictorial fraction there, if you will, on the right. So let's plug in some numbers, see what happens. If x is 0, the answer is 0. If x is a fifth, 0.2, the answer is 0.25, which is a quarter. If the x is 4/10, the answer is 2/3. If x is 5, well, I'm sorry, 0.5, then in 0.5 over 1 minus 0.5 is 0.5 over 0.5, so the answer is 1. So you can see that X is growing, and if you put in higher and higher numbers, it blows up until finally you get to 1, and you've got 0 in the denominator, and it's undefined, so we say, well, that's infinity. So you can graph that, and you get you know, this simple graph of this formula, X over 1 minus X. So now if you graph the value X equals R, you notice that the only intersection there is at 0. So if X is 0, then the ratio is 0. And so there's not a lot of, there's no real constraint between the two, because there's no other value of X that's kind of distinguished there when you equate the two. But remember, it's not just two lines you have. You actually have three quantities here. You have 1 and X and 1 minus X. So let's think about a really simple thing you can do with these three quantities with respect to ratios. And the answer is, well, let's put them together this way. The whole is to the greater part as that part is to the smaller part. And the thing is you ask yourself, well, okay, I don't know what those numbers are, but maybe they could be equal. So you think about that, and then you make yourself a little equation. And so you have 1 over x is the left-hand fraction, and it equals x over 1 over minus x on the right. And you want those to be equal. And if you look at that, you immediately notice, playing around with it, that if x were 0.5, it won't work, because the left-hand will be 2, and the right-hand will be 1, and 2 never equals 1. What that tells you, though, is that the solution is not symmetric, and that's interesting. This very simple declaration of a constraint doesn't have a symmetric solution. So let's do a little bit of math here. So you have the 1 over x equals x over 1 minus x, and you can simplify that to the next 1 minus x equals x squared, put that all on one side. You've got a quadratic equation in x. You just use the quadratic formula to solve it. So you see that x is equal to minus 1 plus or minus the square root of 5 all over 2. So there's two solutions mathematically. One is negative, and we're not going to use that because we're talking about measurement here, and a negative measurement doesn't make sense, especially since we've constrained ourselves between numbers between 0 and 1. But the other solution is 0.618033, the golden section. And it's an irrational number because the square root of 5 is involved, and so those digits go on forever. So everything we're talking about here is essentially an ideal. It's an approximation to this number that's a little bit higher than 3/5, right, 0.6. Well, that's called the golden section, and I like to think of these as dissections because it's two pieces. And the whole is to the greater part as that part is the smaller part. Well, what's the reciprocal? 1 over x. Well, if you put that in a calculator, you say 1 over 0.618033, dot, 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 and it turns out that the reciprocal is 1.618033. So the infinite number of digits are exactly the same. It's repeated. So that means that the reciprocal of this number, 0.618033, et cetera, is one more than the number itself. And that's a unique property, and it's true of the reciprocal and vice versa. So that's kind of an interesting mathematical property of the golden section. And we call this reciprocal the golden ratio. And it's kind of think of it as an improper fraction where the larger part is above in the numerator and the one is in the denominator. So it's equal to 1.618033. Now in math, the golden ratio is represented by the Greek letter phi, sometimes by the Greek letter tau, but we're going to use phi because it's pronounced phi or also phi. And I'm going to play some word games with that in a minute. This number has captured human imaginations like Ryan's quote from Mary Olivio since the ancient Greeks. And the reason, before we get to the reason, where in this room can you find examples of golden ratio use? And I'll give you a hint. It has nothing to do with the Museum of Math. It doesn't have anything to do with the sinks in the bathrooms, which are pentagons. It doesn't have anything to do with the various tilings and exhibits that might be pentagon-based or so forth. So where do you think in this room right now you can find examples of the golden ratio? Any guesses, anybody? Yes?
Human body proportions?
There's a theory about that, but it's kind of bogus. Yeah? Pardon me?
The
I don't know. I haven't measured it. I doubt it, but that's possible. But that doesn't count because that's part of MoMath. So where in your own pockets can you find the golden ratio? All right. If you have an iPhone or an iPad, Apple tells people who develop software like me for the iPad how to design icons. And they give you this grid to lay out your icon imagery in a very simple way. And the grid starts with a square, and you inscribe a circle in it. The circle is the largest square. You then apply the golden ratio to get a smaller circle. And then do it again to get a smaller circle. Now, you can't just go backwards from that, because if you undo it, you just get back to the same circle. So now you cheat a little bit, and you increase it by the square root of 2. Now you can get back to the golden ratio, and you get to that circle, which is the inner circle times the golden ratio. You then draw these lines out to the corners, and these corners right here are where the arcs of the rounded corners are supposed to go through. So that's how all those icons on your iPhone are based on this application of the golden ratio. And if you look, for instance, at the settings icon that Apple designed, those are three concentric circles which have radii based on the golden ratio. Now, why do they do this? Well, because designers and, you know, various other people have for a long time worshipped the golden ratio as some sort of ideal, and they think that it they must be doing something right if they're using it. And I call this faith-based design. And the thing is if you use the numbers 1.6 and 1.4, they would work with almost precisely the same aesthetic results. You wouldn't be able to tell the difference. So what they're doing is it's an homage to an idea or an ideal. But the real goal of a design layout grid is not to use the golden ratio. It's to create a standard so that all sorts of icons have a sort of a comparative look and don't use the similar amount of space. So the golden ratio, which is also has been called the divine proportion, is not. And we need to be very careful about issues of sacred geometry and so forth, where people, as people always do, like to impart a little too much meaning to some of the things that maybe they don't understand as well. In any case, let's look at the golden ratio squared. Okay, so the golden ratio is 1.61803 dot dot dot, and we know that the reciprocal is one away, so you can subtract one to get the reciprocal. And now you multiply by the golden ratio on both sides, so you get this equation, which is the difference between the second power and the first power is one. So we get this identity, and so we see that the square of the golden ratio is 2.618033. So it's the same repeating digits. So it's exactly one more than itself when you square it. Now that's interesting, because this golden ratio identity, it's the fundamental golden ratio identity, I think of it as the sweet spot between additive and exponential growth. On the left side, you have exponential growth. On the right side, it's additive. And so there's something balanced about this, even though it's sort of this asymmetric quantity. So if you look at the golden identity and then assign exponents to all three parts, you see that phi squared equals phi to the 1 plus phi to the 0. Phi to the 0 is 1. That tells you that any power of the golden ratio can be reduced to a simpler expression in just the golden ratio itself without any exponents except 1. So if we take the golden identity here and we multiply it by phi, we get phi cubed equals phi squared plus 1, and that turns out to equal 2 phi plus 1. You can take phi to the fourth, and it's equal to phi cubed plus phi squared, which is, turns out if you reduce it, it's 3 phi plus 2. You can go the other direction. Here's the, what we saw before, the reciprocal is 1 away from the first power. And you can go up and even say that 1 is equal to the reciprocal of golden ratio plus the reciprocal of golden ratio squared. So what's interesting about this, of course, is these integer coefficients, which are the Fibonacci numbers. And the Fibonacci numbers is a huge, the Fibonacci numbers are a growth pattern that are, it's like the discrete form of the golden ratio, and there's all sorts of relationships between them that crop up in a zillion ways, and you can read about all this on the internet. What's interesting here is that these are the Fibonacci numbers also, except that there's that funny one up in the right, and that's actually the minus one Fibonacci number, because Fibonacci numbers go backwards as well as forwards. And so you get to this, experimentally, you get to this identity, where the nth power of the golden ratio is equal to the n minus first plus the n minus second, which reminds you of the definition of Fibonacci numbers, which is the nth Fibonacci number is the sum of the n minus first Fibonacci number and the n minus second Fibonacci number. But the nth power of the golden ratio equals the nth Fibonacci number times phi plus the previous Fibonacci number. Well, the Greeks knew all about the golden ratio geometrically, and one of the things they figured out was that the ratio of a diagonal of the pentagon, the regular pentagon, to the side, if the side is one, is the golden ratio. And they thought this is, this was sort of interesting. They didn't create numeric versions of it because, back then, people were dying because they were arguing that the square root of 2 was irrational. And but look at this, okay? The golden ratio occurs in an equilateral triangle inscribed in a circle. Turns out that if you just extend this side of the inner triangle to the arc of the circle, that triangle cuts that line into a golden ratio. That was discovered within the last 50 years. It's amazing. It's so simple. And it was discovered by a mathematical artist, which I'm happy to say. So where else does the golden ratio occur? Well, this is a famous definition of the golden ratio. It's called a continued fraction, where the denominator of this fraction is a sort of a copy of itself, and it goes on forever. And this is the simplest continued fraction. And why is it related to the golden ratio? For the exact same reason that we just talked about. the denominator of that fraction is the same expression because it goes to infinity. So they're essentially equal. So it's basically the same as the golden identity. Phi equals 1 plus 1 over phi, or phi squared equals phi plus 1. All right, so why does the golden ratio occur in these different ways? And the answer is not because it's divine, not because it's magical, it's not because we should this, that, and the other. It's because it's simple. It's really simple. And so there's only so many very simple constraints in mathematics. And this is akin to an adage in mathematics called Guy's Strong Law of Small Numbers. And Guy's Strong Law of Small Numbers started as a joke, but it's really a truth, which says there aren't enough small numbers in the world for all of the uses we need to put them. So they crop up in different ways. So that's, think of all the places that you see the number 2. Well, there's a lot of really good uses for the number 2, but there's only one number 2. And the same thing is true with constraints in mathematics. There can be, there's only simple constraints, like adding two numbers together and getting a third number, and then putting that into a feedback loop. That's very simple. So that's the real reason that the golden ratio crops up in a lot of different ways. So in the pentagon, let's look at the pentagram, which is all of the diagonals. And the golden ratio happens all throughout here. So we saw that the diagonal to the side is equal to the golden ratio, but you can find it in parts of this. So the side to the portion of that diagonal, and you can use similar triangles to prove this, is also the golden ratio. And the side of that to its base is also the golden ratio. So it crops up in all sorts of ways. And you have these two quantities you're making a ratio with. And if you have two quantities, two lengths, what kind of triangle can you make from it? Well, if you only have two lengths, you can only make isosceles triangles. So it turns out that there are two triangles that are very, very golden. And one of them has a short side and two long sides. One of them has one long side and two short sides. And they're made up of sides and diagonals of the pentagon. So these two golden triangles, if you want, one's bigger than the other, so you can actually do the math and figure out that it's exactly phi squared in area larger than the smaller one. And these two, if you take pairs of them and glue them together, you'll get what are called Penrose tiles. And these were first described in the 1970s. These can create non-periodic tilings that are quite beautiful and have all sorts of interesting structures to them. And they're a little bit related to some other things I'm talking about. But, there's this huge literature about them, lots of good pictures you can find. And I say rediscovered because pentagonal symmetry may have also been used in certain Islamic designs, 500 years ago. And that's been a subject of research in recent years. So the Penrose tiling creates aperiodic tilings. They don't repeat themselves the way a square tiling or a triangular tiling or a hexagonal tiling might. They can in some senses, but what's really cool about them is that they create these aperiodic tilings where you can't translate the tiling in any direction and have it fall right on top of itself. Well, the thing about the two these two triangles that I like and was interested in was the fact that they have a codependent relationship. Or a co-recursive relationship. The diagonal of the pentagon that crosses these cuts these two triangles into two pieces. And look at those two pieces. Those two pieces are identical in aspect ratio to the same two pieces we started with. So A can be carved up into two triangles. One is a smaller copy of A, one is a smaller copy of B. Or actually, it looks like it's an exact copy of B. And then B can be carved up into two triangles. One is a smaller copy of A, and one is a smaller copy of B. Now, there's no other triangle that you can do that with, but it's really kind of beautiful. Now, the interesting thing about that dissection, though, is that you have one bit of freedom. You can choose to carve it up from the lower left to the upper right, or from the lower upper right to the lower left, and do that in each triangle. So if you're going to carve triangles up into smaller and smaller subtriangles, you have this freedom in whatever algorithm you use to play with those symmetries. So let's do an experiment. Let's start showing what that looks like. So here is the taller of those golden rectangles, and we're going to divide it up into two. And we're going to divide each one of those up into two, but I'm making a choice here because I have symmetry choices. So I'll choose that. Now I've got four of these triangles, two of each, and so forth. And we can continue this on every time we double the number of triangles, and obviously you wouldn't want to do this by hand. That's what computers are great for, particularly since they can model geometric numbers and constraints pretty accurately. So let's keep going until we have, I don't know, how about 120,000 golden triangles? And you start seeing these incredible textures. And what's going on here is interesting, and it's cropping up in a very sort of mysterious way, because the golden ratio has this balance. It's the balance between additive and exponential growth. It's the balance that keeps all these triangles, and we can go and look in here, and we'll see that all these triangles have the same shape. It's the exact same set of triangles. If you used any other ratio, you can carve up a triangle into two parts, lots of different ways, but if you use any other ratio, you're going to get an unstable drifting away from the same triangles. And so there is a balance going on here, which is really interesting. Let's try doing that in a different way, because it turns out you get different textures. So we'll carve it up this way. And again, we'll go up to maybe 120,000 triangles, and so we get a different texture, golden texture. So what's happening is the darker parts are where the smallest triangles occur, because you're using a fixed line width to illustrate this. So the smallest triangles are going to have the most black next to them. So that's why there's this variant. But you're seeing something. It's like looking up at the Milky Way in the sky, or maybe it is religious. Maybe it's like the Shroud of Turin and whatever. But that's just, let's try another tactic. Okay, let's do this. Try this dissection, and we'll get a different texture. And this is, I like this. This is kind of intriguing. You get these weird patterns and wonderful, it's all self-referential, and it's fractal and self-similar and so forth. But yeah, it just as a texture, I think it's lovely, and it's balanced. It's as balanced as it can be if it's going to be asymmetric and non-homogeneous. So let's try one more, and this one is really kind of interesting also. What happens here? And what happens is all the small triangles seem to be hewing, wait till it draws, hewing to the larger subdivision lines. So it's sort of all this convergence is going to the original subdivision lines. And you can zoom in and look at this. Oops, I rotated it. Now this is why it's nice to have computers to draw this, because you would not want to do this by hand. Now there's another fun thing you can do, which is when you subdivide, let's carve this triangle up into three triangles and then ignore the shorter one at the top and then subdivide again, the two. And we're going to leave all of those, the B triangles unsubdivided. Okay, and so when we do this, you actually end up getting this fractal, which is, you can zoom in and it's kind of a tree-like structure. And it's composed completely of just the A triangles. All of the B triangles you're not subdividing, so they're elsewhere. And eventually it has zero thickness. And now if you use a different symmetry and do it again, now all the A triangles converge to essentially a snowflake curve, which is the pentagonal snowflake curve. And you can have fun with color now and for instance, start coloring in the triangles you're not subdividing and use three colors and then rotate them. And so you get these converging stars that show you, it's sort of a growth pattern into this fractal. And if we do the other symmetry, we get this. So these stars are converging to different fractals, which is kind of interesting. They all have the same fractal dimension. I just think that's, it's just lovely. And of course, there's local symmetries, but it's asymmetric. And that's what makes it interesting and aesthetically interesting as well as mathematically interesting to my mind. All right, so you can generalize the golden ratio. There's things called silver ratios. The golden ratio is a special example of a silver ratio. Silver ratios exist for all odd-sided polygons, just like the golden ratio exists for the pentagon, the silver ratio is for the heptagon, the nonagon, etc. So for the heptagon, the seven-sided regular polygon, there are three co-recursive triangles, and each one can be carved up into a similar copy of one of the three. And you put them together in three different ways, and I played with this back in the 80s, and this is before PostScript existed in graphical languages, and I was doing pen plotter drawings of this stuff with rapidograph pens and paper and trying to create these huge dissections. So it was a lot of, it was really interesting, and I found new fractals. And so I did this, I found this particular fractal, which is embedded in the tall triangle, and you can find it in the others as well. I called it a hep dragon because it looks very much like a dragon, but it's like the dragon curve in a sense. It's got a fractal boundary, and it's got self-similar parts, but you can look at it this way, and you can see that I've chosen to illustrate it in a very dramatic way, and I think it's a successful, enjoyable thing to contemplate and look at, and it's got a lot of detail. And I also did another experiment with this triplet of heptagon triangles, and I called that a fleur-de-lis. And you take a circle and you divide it into 14 parts, and then those create triangles, and then you recursively subdivide them using the three triangles and play with certain triangles that you don't want to subdivide, and then you play with color, and then it turns out that if you do want to do it, and then you've got the asymmetry, and I just think it's really pretty and fun, and you can look at it, and it's just a myriad set of triangles, three triangles, all the same shape, just different sizes. Well, okay, so let's go on. Now, this golden ratio had these two pieces, and we used them to make a triangle. And it turns out it's pretty elegant. But what else can you do? Can you make a rectangle out of these two pieces? And the answer, of course, is yes. And it's known as the golden ratio, or as I call it, the so-called golden rectangle. Now, I'm going to say some things. This has been worshipped for thousands of years. There's this theory, the Parthenon is based on it, but it's not really true. And you can find it embedded in the icosahedron or the dodecahedron, and the golden ratio is in, the four-dimensional dodecahedron, and there's lots of places. And there's this theory about art frames being the best when they're the golden ratio. But I'm going to prove to you that it's really at best the goldenish rectangle. And in fact, it's kind of miserable. So I tend to call it the miserable golden rectangle. And I'm telling you, it's not, I'll explain. Okay, so what is it that everybody oohs and ahs about with the golden rectangle? Well, you can carve off a smaller golden rectangle on the right side. And if it's golden, the leftover, or the nomen, to use the Greek word, the leftover when you take a self-similar part away from something, is the unit square. Well, okay, I'll grant you that that's the only rectangle that can be true for, and that's based on the fundamental identity. But you can do that again. So you carve another one off, and it's a ratio, another golden section, and you're left with another square, and you can do that again. So you get these squares that reduce in size by the golden ratio each time, and you can do these goldenectomies forever, and obviously there's something interesting going on. If you do this ad infinitum, there's some point of convergence there. And it's at the intersection of these two diagonals. So you can actually very quickly figure out what the coordinates of those diagonals is by just summing two infinite series of squares. The white square is summing to the right, and the blue square is summing upwards. And you find the coordinates are 1.17 and 0.72, which happen, well, they don't happen to be. Of course, their ratio is the golden ratio. Well, there's another cool thing you can do. That shows you that you can divide the golden rectangle up into four pieces that are all the exact same shape. Only in the limit, they're the exact same shape in the limit. And that's, I'll admit, that's kind of interesting, but they're not similar to the original. They're sort of, it's an artificial construct. Well, then there's the golden spiral. Everybody hears about the golden spiral, and it's basically based on putting a spiral into this set of reduced squares. And the problem is, of course, is that's not the golden spiral. I just fooled you. Okay, my presentation software only draws circular arcs. It doesn't draw logarithmic spirals. It looks like a logarithmic spiral. It's real close to the logarithmic spiral, but it's not. And this has fooled lots of people for a long time. For instance, there's all sorts of talk about the golden ratio, being implicit in how a nautilus shell grows. Well, yes, a nautilus shell grows exponentially, but it's not really clear that golden ratio has much of anything to do with it at all. And there's a paper about this that was done by yet another mathematical artist a couple of years ago. Published in the Bridges Conference, and you can find this on the web at their archives, and it's a great explanation of the bogosity of this of this theory that the golden ratio occurs all throughout nature. So here's my complaint from a self-similarity recursive subdivision point of view, like we were doing with the triangle, the goldenish rectangle, it's just second rate. It's just unworthy of all this attention that's so steamingly heaped upon it. And I'm going to prove to you that it's completely useless. Okay, so The problem with the unit square is there's nothing golden about it that's worth recommending at all. There's nothing golden about a unit square. It's only, you know, this piece you took off. So the golden rectangle is at least 61.8033% useless. But of course, you can do the same thing again. And now we add the uselessness, and we get up to 85%. And we add the uselessness, and now we're up to 94%. Now you can do that forever. And in fact, mathematically, you can compute the limit of all those sums of squares. And it's the golden rectangle in completion, except for one point. That's that one point where it converged. That's the interesting thing there. Everything else is useless. All right. So something is deeply wrong here. What happened to all the elegance? Everybody's been saying the golden rectangle is just awesome, and it's been around for thousands of years, et cetera, et cetera. It's like being sold a fine steak that is over 61% fat and having to feed it to Fido. The problem is that we've been shoehorning the golden ratio's one-dimensional elegance into the wrong two-dimensional rectangle. So let's get back to first principles. What's the question? The question is, how many ways can a rectangle be subdivided into n self-similar sub-rectangles? Well, if you have n equals 4, it's pretty obvious that works, because you're basically carving a rectangle up into two halves, and all four of them are similar to the whole. They're each half size, so that's pretty obvious. That's trivial. And then if you think about it, then it works for any n that's a square of some integer. So it works for n equals 16, or n equals 25, or n equals 100. And they're all similar to the whole, so you can solve it for n equals a square number. But what about a simple number like 2? What about 3? For 2, there's only one distinct way in. It's the 1 by the square root of 2 rectangle. And you can cut it in half, and the two halves have the same aspect ratio. They're rotated, which is interesting. And in fact, this is the basis for European paper sizes. So the A1, A2, A3, and A4 paper sizes are all based on carving rectangles up into two pieces by the square root of 2. This proves that the Europeans are much smarter than we are, because when we carve pieces of paper up, we have these extra leftovers and the aspect ratio changes. But they've got a really elegant thing going over there. Well, what about 3? It turns out that if you go through sort of all of the possible ways you can carve up rectangles, there's 3 distinct solutions. And what do you think the aspect ratios are? Well, any guesses? If you think about what I just explained with the root 2, obviously there's 1 by root 2. So that left one is 1.4142, that's the square root of 2. The middle one, if you know your math, recognize that, that's the square root of 3. And then there's this number 1.2720. What the heck is that? The answer is the square root of 2, the square root of 3, and the square root of the golden ratio. So here's this rectangle that's 1 by the square root of 5, 1.2, which is, turns out, extremely golden. And I consider this the better golden rectangle. And so I'm going to call it GR for golden rectangle. It's 1 by the square root of phi. So on the lower left, you have the, and we're going to scale it up. And we're going to multiply it on both horizontal and vertical dimensions by the golden ratio squared, which is equal to r to the fourth. So it turns out to be an r to the fourth by r to the fifth rectangle. Now, what does that teach you? Immediately, you can see that r to the fifth, since it's a rectangle, it has to be equal to r to the third plus r. And immediately you see that r to the fourth has to be the same length as r squared plus 1. Well, what are those? Guess what? We're right back where we started to the fundamental golden ratio identity, because you can divide those equations, those identities in r by the square root by r, and then just take the square, r squared equals phi. And here's the fun thing. It works for areas as well as linear dimensions. So this is r fifth. What's the area of the whole thing? It's r to the fifth times r to the fourth. What's the area of this? It's r to the fourth times r to the third. So the area is r ninth of the whole. This is r to the seventh. This is r to the third. And this is r. So you have that identity. So you can say r, and you can simplify that to phi to the fourth equals phi third plus phi plus one. And that simplifies down to the usual golden identity. So that's kind of cool too, because you're getting the same identity in both one-dimensional and two-dimensional areas. But now every part is useful for recursive subdivision, just like in the triangular case. But you have 4 choices of symmetry here. You have essentially each of the 4 possible ways you can divide this golden rectangle up into 3 parts that are self-similar are equivalent to different origins, different coordinate systems at the 4 corners. And that's really useful when you're writing, say, PostScript programs, because it's very easy to do these transformations in PostScript. So That means, because each of these are three different independent rectangles, that means that there's 64 possible ways that you can choose these subdivisions. So you've got a space that you can explore. And you can't visualize it very easy. You don't know what's going to happen. So let's look at another demo. Let's do this down maybe 16,000 times. So here's 16,000 golden rectangles. And they tile the original golden rectangle. And they start creating textures. And some of them are more interesting than others. So let's scroll through some of these 64. And you see that you're getting groupings of the smallest into interesting structures. And suddenly you start seeing emergent patterns and where there's maybe some spiraling going on. And it's all based on this tree of linear transformations that are positioning this myriad set of shapes in different sizes, all the same shape in different ways. So it's asymmetric. And then, suddenly this is looking like it used to be straight lines, but now it's gotten kind of wavy. And this looks like it's sort of a gasket, a fractal gasket. And you can go on and see these textures. And then suddenly, whoa, it's the same rectangle, but now it's rotated a bit. So how can all these little tiny rectangles that are all, at right angles create these larger rectangles that are at a diagonal? That's kind of interesting. And then this one is really weird because you get the same rectangle. You can sort of see this rectangle there. But then it sort of deteriorates and just melts away in these areas. It's like it's rotting. It's very strange. And so, what's going on is this. These patterns are interacting with your visual system, and they're firing neurons in your brain to remind you of, this one reminds me of, for some reason, I keep thinking of Siamese cats when I look at this. I don't know why. And then you get sort of these fractal structures, and, they're all recursive and self-similar, and then but you get these emergent lines, and they're related to the golden ratio and the angles, and it's wonderful that these crop up because you're discovering the patterns before you're discovering the constraints. I really like that. That's a really strange and interesting pattern there, really unexpected. And, they're just lovely. And, this one is obviously very organized from the largest to the smallest golden rectangles. So it sort of has this sweep of getting darker towards, but it's all hierarchical. And this one I really like a lot for various reasons. And, it goes on and on. So I did this piece called Fiber Space, and it was based on one of these dissections. But then at the last minute, I took away all of the golden rectangles, and I substituted a different rectangle that was sort of inset, and it wasn't a true golden rectangle. But I widened the lines, I used colors, and I superimposed them all each other. And amazingly enough, by choosing just slight variations, I came up with a design where you see nothing but hierarchical set of spirals. It's like, if you actually look at this, there are no spirals in this picture whatsoever. It's you've got this tree of linear transformations that creates this set of spirals implicitly, but then when you actually impart some aesthetic choices or just play, and they pop out at you. And I really like this. My sister's going to make a quilt out of this. But in any case, when you look at this, you'll see that there's a whole slew of different sizes of golden triangles, from the largest in the lower left, down to the little minutest down here, and then there's the largest. So it's an interesting question is, why have this tree of subdivision be all the same depth? So that introduces the idea of lag subdivision. So and what that does is it creates a more homogeneous set of these tiles in the subdivision. And if you look at the area sum, you say, well, let's subdivide the larger ones more than the smaller ones. That should work. And because of the identity, what you can do is you can subdivide the largest one twice the level as the medium-sized one, which is one times the level of the smallest. So, and then when you're doing that, let's scale the picture up by r squared each time, which what that means is that the smallest triangles in these resultant subdivisions are going to be 1 by r at every stage. Let's look at this. So here's the first level subdivision. And do it again, but we're not subdividing this one and this one yet, but we did subdivide the big one here. And notice we've got two rectangles here that are the same size. And we do it again, and we've got two over here the same size. And finally we start subdividing on this side because you're creating only a set of four of these golden triangles that tile the original. And you keep subdividing, and because of the symmetry that I chose here, you get these patterns, which are really kind of remarkable because they're not symmetric, they're aperiodic, they're completely regular in some sense, and you can't see where the original subdivision is anymore. The original subdivision's there, but you're getting this emergent structure out of this simply by introducing this lag time. So let's try it again with this. This is a different symmetry. Now what's interesting here is now you've got a bilaterally symmetric subdivision. And it stays bilaterally symmetric up until an asymmetry is introduced. So it's asymmetric for a little while, and it goes back to being bilaterally symmetric. And as you go down deeper and deeper, you get what I call the golden plaid design. And if you look at these bars, there's two here, but then there's one, then there's two, and so forth. And there's almost certainly a relationship to what's called the golden, I can't remember, I'm having drawn a blank, but there's a sequence of ones and zeros that's called the Fibonacci number. And it's probably related to that because of the way that these linear transformations work. Let's look at the counts of these rectangles, okay? So there's one tan, there's no purples, there's one blue, there's one sort of maroon. And that those numbers correspond to coefficients in this expression in the four powers of the golden ratio. So phi to the fourth, remember we scaled this up, is equal to phi third plus phi plus one. And phi to the fifth is equal to phi to the third plus phi squared plus two phi plus one, et cetera, et cetera. So you can get all the way up to, say, phi to the 15th equals 169 phi cubed plus 104, et cetera, et cetera. Well, use the golden identity to simplify this, okay? And you simplify this down to phi to the 15th equals this expression just in the golden ratio, and then you combine like terms and you get phi to the 15th equals 610 phi plus 377. And if you know your Fibonacci numbers, those are Fibonacci numbers, the 15th Fibonacci number and the 14th Fibonacci number. So that's a visual proof of this identity that the nth power of the golden ratio is the nth Fibonacci number times phi plus the n minus first Fibonacci number. So there's phi to the 18th right there. And it equals, you know, those two Fibonacci numbers, et cetera. So these are we'll scroll through some of these. Each of these is a different one of the 64 symmetries, and each one creates an aperiodic tiling. And, you know, some of them are just sort of, it's strange. They're homogeneous, they're sort of random, and then you come up with this incredibly organized tiling, except you notice there's a bar down this side and a bar along the top that's half the size of these. And it's the same set of tiles, they're just being organized by a different set of symmetries out of the 64 possibilities. So you get these diagonal lines that come in pairs and singletons, and you know, it's much more homogeneous. It's not as textural as the previous ones, because there's only four sizes of tile here. And yet, they tile a copy of themselves in the large scale. So this is just an exploration of structure. And there's more plaids here. This one, it looks like it's bilaterally symmetric. And this one's kind of clumpy and sort of, you know, there's sort of local symmetries here and there, and you get that another plaid and sort of a choppy bunch of lines this way. And so it's just, you know, it's this fabulous, and here you get some large scale structure where you see that there's sort of a line like this. Where is it? No, I can't see it from this angle very much, but it goes up this way. You can sort of see that there's some large scale structure going on there. And that one's really kind of interesting, where there's this clumping going on with like triangle, like rectangles, et cetera. Anyway, let me finish up and show you what last thing this is related to, which is what's called the Amann's B tile. And it's derived from the better golden rectangle. And this tile has a property that with it and a copy of itself mirrored and smaller, it can tile the plane just like squares can, except it's completely aperiodic. Where did it come from? You know, when Amann described this in 1978, he didn't explain it very well. These are his notes. And he was interested in what are called reptiles, which is figures that can be carved up into copies of themselves, like the square. So he sent these notes to Martin Gardner, who ran the mathematical games column at Scientific American in February 78. And he says, oh, look, the square root of the golden ratio, and he just drew this ab initio, and it doesn't explain where he got it from. Well, it's the goal. If you take away C and then subdivide A once and rearrange and glue the pieces together differently, you get the etymology of Amann's tile. This is a reduced copy of this by R, and together, and it's also, notice, it's a mirror image. And so together, the two create a recursive subdivision, which is, the moment I thought about that, I said, oh, well, I know about those. In any case, so Gardner, it was Amon wrote this to Gardner. He said, you know, these are reptiles and their boundaries can have, they can be related to fractal curves. Remember, this is only a year after Malebro had his first English book on fractals out in 77. And the part about this I like is where he says, I believe these tiles would be a good subject for computer art and would have produced them by computer myself if I had access to an XY plotter. This is 1978. Now, Amon was very eccentric. He probably was, I don't know, I think he was autism spectrum. He died in obscurity. He didn't give lectures. He just wrote this stuff. And so Martin Gardner wrote to Solomon Gollum, who was invented the term reptiles and also pentaminoes, if you're familiar with those. He says, this might be of interest to you. I've also given a copy to Malebro. He's some sort of genius who moves about from address to address in Massachusetts and seems to have no fixed means of livelihood. He hasn't told me anything about himself beyond that he has done some sort of trading in computer science. From time to time, he sends me results on this and that, the enclosed being the latest. Well, 2 years later, I ended up being Malebro's, one of his several programmer illustrators, and Benoit Malebro gave me these notes from Amon and said, what do you make of this? And I looked at it and my head exploded. How could he figure this out? Where does the square root of the golden ratio come from? And then we moved on to other things. We actually never illustrated from it or explored those fractal curves that he was sure were there. And then a couple of years later, I derived this for myself, just trying to say, well, what rectangles are self-similar? And then I realized this was related to Amon's B tile and had these notes that I still had. And so I did this originally as a plotter drawing, and it's got about 40,000 golden bees in it. You know, it's maybe this wide. And I've done it 5 feet wide on a later printer, not a pen plotter. And this I call golden gnomon because gnomon is the Greek word for what's left over after you take away something self-similar. So all of the recursive subdivided area here is what's left over when you take away the red, which is self-similar. Now, what's interesting about this is the structure. Where is the golden bee in all this? Well, you start out with three of them, right, like that. And you're left over with the red. And I decided, well, I think that's really bold and interesting. It's asymmetric. And I really like the idea of just having that there left over and recursively subdividing all this black and white. And so you can apply this recursive subdivision down to about 14, 15 levels and get 40,000 of these things. Now, the interesting thing is that there's this line across the top, which is the original rectangle. So obviously, it's straight. But then you can see that there are other cleavage lines in here that, lo and behold, are spaced according to, you guessed it, the golden ratio. And it goes horizontally as well as vertically. And I was looking at this thinking, oh, those are interesting cleavage lines. And then I was looking really close, and you notice something kind of funny, which is there's a break in this cleavage line. There's one golden bee tile right there at this sort of, it's the locally largest, and it's where diagonals of these lines intersect. And so I said, well, that's interesting. So let's count those up. There's one there. Where's the next one's in the next line? Well, there's one over there. There's two here. There's three here. There's five here. There's eight here. And lo and behold, there you go. The Fibonacci numbers are back. So, you know, the Fibonacci numbers and the golden ratio are intimately connected in all sorts of interesting ways. And I think this is a successful piece of art, as well as mathematical art, as well as mathematics. And that's, it lives really up there close to the top of that arc. Because in some sense, it's, you know, it's like the best of both worlds. It's platonic, but it's rich in texture, and it looks like it's, you know, they've made these choices, and it's very striking visually, and it's fun to see when it's very large. Anyway, so conclusion. So recursive subdivisions are really, they're trees of linear transformations applied iteratively, and that's why you get fractals, because there's, you know, fractals are generally generated iteratively. And phi is this balance point. It keeps these iterations stable and well-behaved, which has graphical implications. And you get these incredible textures and patterns, and they're aperiodic. And so there's this rich, rich visual world that accrues. Now, with respect to the goldenish rectangle, I just got to say, I'm sorry. As a self-referential construct, the usual miserable goldenish rectangle deserves at least 61.8033% less respect or worship than it generally garners. It plainly suffers from what I call a golden identity crisis, unlike the true golden rectangle. And Whereas the true golden rectangle, the 1/√5 rectangle, is a lean golden mean aesthetic fist-fighting machine. So to the infidel, miserable golden rectangle, this aficionado most confidently shouts, to fie heaven, fie on thee, you perfidious figment of fine platonic design. A new rectangle's in town. Your days of divinity are finitely numbered, and your history, with the P silent there, is finally finished. I, for one, root for root fie by one. Aman. So the speaker, being me, disavows any support for any tenet of proportional divinity, sacred geometry, numerology, or other faith-based attempts to impart mysterious meaning to the myriad emergent phenomena of mathematical constraints whose beauties can only be understood from a position of enlightened and rational strength. Caveat emptor. So this is based on a paper I wrote. Thank you. It's on the Bridges website if you want to read it. It's, it doesn't have stuff about the triangles in it. This talk is an expansion of that. I create giclée prints of various sizes, and if you really, really like some of these designs, I actually spend a lot of my time on researching and playing with space-filling curves, which are a different form of recursive geometries. And some of the scarves I've designed are available in the shop upstairs. And I'm also working on an ebook for the Mac and for the iPad called The Outside In and Inside Gone, which is on generalized recursive Hilbert and Hef domino curves, and hopefully that will be out sometime this year. So, quad erat demonstrandum, or questions engendering discussion. Thank you.
All right, I see a hand up in the back.
You alluded to earlier about, you know, the connection with the nautilus shell, or perceived connection with the nautilus shell. A lot of your patterns that you're putting up there reminded me of snakes and reptile patterns and
yeah,
things like that.
Right.
Yeah, I guess what I was wondering is, in any of the research explorations, has anybody looked at connections between patterns that occur in nature and some of these?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And, you know, the Fibonacci numbers occur in nature, but that's because it's a discrete pattern, and so there's a stability to discrete, you know, in pine cones or pineapple or sunflower, sunflower florets and a lot of other flower florets, you can find spirals that are based on Fibonacci numbers where you count them in one counterclockwise or clockwise, you get Fibonacci numbers or adjacent Fibonacci numbers. And you know, there's anywhere in nature where there's growth, there can be constraints. And the thing about nature is the best way we have to model nature, to understand nature, is to use the math that we know. And it turns out it's really good at modeling a lot of things in nature. But you never, ever quite know whether your mathematical model is really the accurate explanation. It might be the best explanation or the simplest mathematical explanation you have, but you never quite know whether it's really accurate or not. Okay, you know, for instance, Newton's laws of motion, they seemed like they were pretty solid for there a couple hundred years, and it turns out that they were really kind of approximations that don't always work. And so the golden ratio is a little too pristine, whereas the Fibonacci numbers actually, you know, occur, and you know, they're intimately related. But people like to create meaning, and, you know, so the reason that we have the golden ratio celebrated in books on sacred geometry and so forth is because people like to give meaning to it. It makes them feel happy, and designers do that, and, you know, people have done it with the nautilus shell, et cetera. So it's a little intellectually dicey to do that. It's an interesting exercise to do actual real scientific testing with, but nobody does those actual real scientific tests on it. You know, you could test the preferences of every human on the planet as to which rectangle they like the best and average them all out so that you know the exact answer. And what would you do if it turned out to be 1.573332314 instead of the golden ratio? It's close to the golden ratio, so maybe there's something interesting going on there having to do with people's preferences for asymmetry, but it's not clear that there's any relationship to the golden ratio at all. It's just this ideal that happens to be very simple, and we have this belief that the world is governed by simple laws, so, you know, maybe it'll work out, but it's just a belief.
Has there been any mathematical art research done with the Lucas numbers, which are related to, they're like a conjugate cousin of the Fibonacci's, the Lucas numbers?
I'm not really aware of them. I mean, they grow in the same, I mean, they have, adjacent Lucas numbers, I believe, have the same ratio as the golden ratio. I think because it's the same, it's basically the same recurrence formula, but with different initial conditions. So, ultimately, I think it's basically it converges to the same golden ratio. And so, there might be really interesting differences down in the low numbers, because there's only so many low numbers to fit the patterns we want to use them for. But I'm not aware of that.
Does anything interesting happen if you attempt to make some similar mapping in non-Euclidean space?
Probably.
you haven't tried.
No. but you know, the thing is that there are mappings from Euclidean space to non-Euclidean space. So if something interesting happened there, it's kind of likely, maybe, I don't know, maybe not, that you would have an analog back in Euclidean space that was interesting too. But, you know, it's all about exploring it and seeing what happens.
All right, let's give another hand for Doug.